The most common piece of wood in the world, the 2x4, is actually not what the name suggests. Its dimensions are 1.5 by 3.5 inches. To many, especially people outside of North America, this seems ridiculous. And I agree, this is so misleading. The actual reason for this goes back more than a century ago, when most dimensional lumber in the United States was produced by local manufacturers and only sold to customers in the vicinity of the mill. The mills produced rough lumber, which was not uniform in width nor had standard dimensions. The builders were accustomed to manually plane the boards on site and make them fit the project. By the late 1800s, the forests near the larger cities were depleted, so lumber was not a locally made commodity anymore and had to be shipped greater distances. At this point in time, railroad shipping was still extremely expensive, often double as expensive as the lumber itself, so the manufacturers had to get creative. They figured out that instead of shipping rough lumber, which is then planed at the construction site, resulting in tons of wasted material, they could provide the surfacing at the mill before shipping and in that way reduce the weight of the shipment. The opening of the Panama Canal in 1914 further complicated things. This new and considerably shorter shipping route made it possible for the mills on the West Coast to compete for the East Coast markets. Since ocean rates are based on volume, the wood manufacturers had an even greater incentive to start shaving off any volume they could. As a result, the manufacturers with the long haul tried to meet the competitor's price by putting on the market thinner lumber, thereby equalizing the difference in the freight rates. They still called the product a 2x4, even though it was a smaller dimension. The justification was that the original rough lumber before surfacing was a 2x4, and therefore the final product could also be called a 2x4. At this point in time, the name 2x4 was not reserved for a specific type of board, so there was no legal standard that would force the mills to have a specific dimension for their 2x4s. The continuous price wars caused the mills to push the thickness of the 2x4 down as much as the market would allow. The name 2x4 had a different meaning for every region in the US. The tables in the book Lumber and Its Uses from 1914 illustrate the dimensional mess perfectly. The dimensions varied based on the number of sites surfaced, intended use, wood species, location, and so on. As you can imagine, the retail dealers were not happy with the situation. Filling up their stockpiles with different versions of 2x4s impeded their business, so naturally, they were the ones that pushed hardest for a nationwide standard. As a consequence, the Department of Agriculture in 1919 set out the Forest Products Laboratory to investigate which dimension would be most suitable to be adopted as a standard. They investigated 75 mills and gave extended consideration for the most economical thickness of lumber for both manufacturers and customers. They found out that more than 60% of the producers were surfacing the 2-inch side of their boards down to 1 5/8. So it was natural to make this dimension a national standard. Furthermore, they concluded that 1 5/8 is the optimal size for joists and studs, and that anything above this dimension would add to the cost but not increase its usefulness. So what they were actually saying was that these boards are already strong enough for the things we build. We don't need to make them any larger, just to fit the name. The claim that 1 5/8 by 3 5/8 was the optimal size is debatable at best. Any size can be made optimal by adjusting the spacing of the joists or studs, though that would likely result in very awkward spacing dimensions. Furthermore, loading conditions across the US are so vastly different. What is optimal for the Midwest would likely not be optimal for the East Coast, for example. But regardless of that, the standard had a bigger problem to deal with, and that was the moisture content specification, which was very hard to enforce at this point in history, since it was difficult to measure the moisture content of the lumber. As a result, mills started to surface their lumber green, meaning while it's still wet and bulky, and ship it off as such. When the boards would dry up, its size would shrink down to below the standard dimension. The fact that ocean fares did not charge by weight, but by volume, further supported this trend of shipping heavy, wet lumber. So once again, there was a downward pressure on the dimension of the 2x4. But with the onset of the Great Depression in 1929, the demand for lumber plummeted, and so did the competitive nature of the industry. For the next 10 years, there were no major changes or push for a new standard. During World War II, lumber was in short supply. Manufacturers tried to produce lumber as cheaply as possible, in many cases deviating from the standard. There was also a widespread belief that wood had an ample reserve strength capacity and that further reducing the dimensions would not cause any major problems. The trend of ever thinner lumber continued after the war. In the late 50s and early 60s, the standard was once again open for discussion. Western manufacturers proposed a reduction in the 2-inch side down to 1.5 inches, while the 4-inch side would remain 3 and 5/8 as before. Their argument was that the thickness of the board did not affect the bending capacity of the joist much anyway. The bending capacity is more influenced by the width since it is the cube dimension in the moment of inertia formula. Whether this was the decisive argument or it was the general will of the industry to go thinner is hard to tell, but in 1963, the American Lumber Standard Committee approved the new standard of the 2x4, this time being 1.5 by 3 and 5/8. This dimension was later amended once more to the final size used today. Today, a 2x4 does start off as a rough cut 2x4, but after drying and surfacing, the final 1.5 by 3.5 dimension is achieved, which is the one available for purchase in a retail store. A reasonable question that is often asked today is, why don't the mills start with a slightly larger dimension and surface it down to an exact 2x4? As we saw in the video, the problem was never getting the correct dimension, but rather saving on material and mostly on shipping costs, which were astronomical back then. In my opinion, the current sizes are well suited for light frame construction, roofing joists, and other smaller projects. This video focuses only on the 2x4, but this history is applicable to all dimensional lumber sizes. If you enjoyed the video, subscribe to the channel. This will help us greatly.